Hello everyone, it's my pleasure to present a polynomial time classical algorithm for noisy random circuit sampling. This is joint work with Dorit Aharonov, Xun Gao, Zef Landau, and Umesh Vazirani. So the motivation of this work came from the recent quantum supremacy experiments, where Google claims a quantum breakthrough that could change computing. So the task that was performed in these experiments is called random circuit sampling, which consists of three steps. First, we use current noisy intermediate scale quantum devices to sample from a random quantum circuit. And second, because of these experiments are very noisy, we use a statistical test to evaluate how good the device is performing. And finally, we claim that the same performance cannot be achieved classically. So in this talk, we will discuss recent progress understanding the complexity of random circuit sampling. So here is a model of the RCS experiments. First, we sample a random circuit C acting on n qubits with depth d. So a random circuit is displayed on the right-hand side. Here, each small white box indicates an independently sampled 2-qubit unitary gate from the Hall measure. And here we also want the circuit depth to be at least log n for the purpose of satisfying a property called anti-concentration, which says that the output distribution is spread out. And this property helps with the statistical verification. Next, we fix the circuit and then obtain m samples by running the same circuit m times on a quantum computer. And of course, the computer will be noisy as indicated by the blue dots here, which is a simple model says that each qubit at each time step is subject to an arbitrary small amount of noise that is of constant strength independent of the system size. So the samples will be come from a noisy distribution denoted by P tilde. Next, we want to compute a statistical measure, which is simply a function of the quantum circuit C as well as the m samples. And this usually takes exponential time in number of qubits to compute. And finally, we repeat the procedure for a few quantum circuits. So in 2019, Google implemented random circuit sampling on up to 53 qubits with depth 20. And their device has roughly 1% noise per gate. And in their experiment, given m samples from the device, they compute the measure called linear cross entropy, which is a simple linear function of the ideal output probabilities corresponding to these samples. Roughly speaking, this quantity is a score between 0 and 1, where 0 means trivial uniform sampling, and 1 means perfect sampling from the ideal experiments. In Google's experiment, they achieve a score of 0.002, which is indeed very far from ideal, but nevertheless achieves a tiny score. In 2021, Pan Chen and Zhang developed a brute force tensor network algorithm to achieve the same task using roughly 500 GPUs in 15 hours. However, this algorithm inherently runs in exponential time, and it is unlikely to be practical with larger system size. So what is happening here is that there is an exciting race between classical and quantum. Since 2019, there has been larger random circuit sampling experiments with up to 60 qubits. And the question is, will there be new spoofing algorithms for larger experiments? So one of the motivations behind these exciting developments is to explore the high complexity regime. So the extended Church-Turing thesis says that any reasonable model of computation can be efficiently simulated on a probabilistic Turing machine, where efficient refers to polynomial time. And we know that quantum computing should be a violation of the extended Church-Turing thesis. And the motivation for quantum supremacy is to make this happen sooner by demonstrating an experimental violation of extended Church-Turing thesis using NISQ devices. And there are two central aspects in this pursuit. The first one is computational complexity, which asks, does the model of noisy random circuit sampling violate the extended Church-Shrink thesis in the asymptotic sense? And the second aspect is finite size experiments, which asks, does the current 53 to 60 qubit experiments take a lot of resources to simulate classically? So here we will focus on the first aspect, which is the evidence of high complexity. And we will only focus on the noisy regime, where we want to show that even the tiny XCB, such as the 0.002 in Google's experiment, is already hard to achieve classically. In 2019, Aarons and Gunn formulated a conjecture called XQoS, and it says that even a tiny correlation on the order of 1 over 2 to the n with the ideal RCS distribution is hard to achieve classically. And this can be viewed as evidence to support the high complexity in Google's experiments. And the reason that they need to formulate this strong conjecture with a tiny parameter of order 2 to the n minus n was because this strong parameter was necessary to support the hardness of achieving tiny XCB. However, in 2021, the recent work of Gao et al. Cast doubt on these arguments by essentially showing that XQoS conjecture is false. But there could still be other conjectures and the statistical tests that provide hardness of the experiments. And therefore, this reopens the question of, is there high complexity in noisy RCS experiments? So here is our main result. So let's consider a noisy random circuit sampling experiment that produces M samples as shown in the blue box. So we give a classical algorithm that can also produce M samples as shown in the green box, which takes time polynomial in M, which is just slightly slower than the experiments. Moreover, the classical algorithm, these samples produced by the classical algorithm comes from a distribution that is so close to the experiments such that no statistical test can tell the difference between the experiment and the classical algorithm. So here's the more formal version of the result, which essentially says that we can input a random circuit C on n qubits. We can essentially sample from a distribution that is very close to the noisy output distribution in total variation distance in polynomial time. So this result has some assumptions. In particular, it requires anti-concentration, which was also required by the experiments. And then we also need randomness in the gate set. So this improves the previously known results by Gao and Duan in 2018, which has running time n to the o of log 1 over epsilon. So roughly speaking, this improvement is important because we will see later that we want to choose epsilon to be very small, and therefore the improvement of polynomial time is essential. So next, we will discuss how to understand this result. So the main significance of this result comes from comparing classical simulation and quantum experiments. And in particular, it is related to statistical indistinguishability, which is a simple fact saying that two probability distributions cannot be distinguished by any statistical test on M samples, let's say with probability 51%, if those distributions are 0.01 over M close in total variation distance. And therefore, if the experiment collects M samples, then we can just choose epsilon to be 0.01 over M, and then we will have running time polynomial nm for the classical algorithm in order to be indistinguishable from the experiment. And here we need to emphasize that currently this running time is not practical, which scales roughly like m to the 1 over gamma, where gamma is noise per gate. And therefore, this does not directly address the hardness of finite size experiments. So next, we will discuss how does the number of samples m scale in terms of the circuit parameters. And this is related to the role of circuit depths. So roughly speaking, the experiments are very noisy, and therefore we need enough samples in order to detect a non-trivial quantum signal from the experiment. So here is the situation. We have the uniform distribution and the ideal random circuit distribution, which is far from uniform. However, due to noise, the random circuit distribution on a noisy quantum computer will be exponentially close to uniform with circuit depths. And therefore, in order to even just tell the difference between the experiment and the trivial uniform distribution, we already need to collect at least 2^d samples. This means that in general, both the experiment and our classical algorithm have random time exponential in circuit depths. This means that using a large circuit depth is not practical for both the experiment and our algorithm. However, there is a very specifically interesting regime of theta log n depths. Recall that we have this anti-concentration property, which is a central assumption for both the experiment and our algorithm, and that needs at least log n depths. On the other hand, we also want the experiment to have polynomial sample complexity. And this means that the circuit depths can be at most O log n. And therefore, this means that theta log n depths is the sweet spot for scalable quantum supremacy. Because in this regime, the experiment satisfies anti-concentration and also have polynomial sample complexity. And in this very interesting regime, both the experiment and our algorithm have polynomial running time. Okay, so here is the summary of the results. The running time of our algorithm is at most polynomial in the running time of the experiment in order to be indistinguishable from the experiments. And in particular, at theta log n depths, both the experiment and our algorithm have polynomial running time. And based on these conclusions, we conclude that noisy random circuit sampling cannot be the basis of a scalable experimental validation of the extended Church-Turing thesis. Next, let's discuss the proof sketch. So we will start with the intuition behind prior hardness arguments for these tasks, which is the Feynman path integral. So let's consider a quantum circuit written as d layers of unitary gates. The Feynman path integral is a simple fact which decomposes the transition amplitude of the quantum circuit into the sum of the product of many transition amplitudes with each layer of the quantum circuit by inserting these computational basis vectors x1 up to xd minus 1. So roughly speaking, each term on the right-hand side can be viewed as a Feynman path, which is multiplying the transition amplitude of each layer of the gates, and then we sum them up together to get the overall transition amplitude. So the intuition behind Aaronson and Chen in 2016 says that all of these Feynman paths on the right-hand side should contribute equally for a random circuit. And there are exponentially many of these paths in total. So if we imagine a classical algorithm as just summing over polynomially many paths here, then that algorithm can only get exponentially small correlation with the ideal distribution. And therefore, they conjecture that no classical algorithm can achieve better than 1 or 2^d in correlation with the ideal distribution. However, there is a second intuition here which borrows from the noise sensitivity of Boolean functions. So let's just consider a very simple model here. Let's consider a probability distribution viewed as a Boolean function. And this distribution is corrupted by noise, where we first sample from the distribution P and then replace each bit by a random bit with some constant probability. So the noise sensitivity says that this distribution has a low degree approximation by summing over the low degree Fourier coefficients when the distribution P has anti-concentration, meaning that it has small second moments. And this fact is very easy to prove using the standard technique of Cauchy-Schwarz, orthogonality, Parseval, and finally using the second norm bound. So what is interesting here is that these two intuitions seems to be in tension, where the first one says that it should be hard to get a tiny correlation. And the second intuition says that the noisy distribution has a low degree approximation, therefore should be simple. So next, we will actually show how to combine the two intuitions nicely. So our algorithm is in fact just a different way of doing the Feynman path integral by decomposing the Pauli basis, which we call the Pauli path integral. So the main difference is that on the left-hand side, we have the Feynman path integral, which inserts these computational basis elements in between each layer. And the contribution is roughly uniform across each of different paths. However, on the right-hand side, we have the Pauli path integral, where we insert Pauli matrices as an operator basis in between each layer. And what happens here is that due to noise, the Pauli basis happens to have the special property that the contribution of a Pauli path decays exponentially with the number of non-identity elements in the path. And to make this algorithm work, we need two main ideas. The first idea is that in the Pauli basis, the contribution of the paths are highly non-uniform, and therefore we order the paths by importance and only consider the most important paths in our simulation algorithm. And the second idea is that we need to actually design an efficient algorithm to calculate those important paths, which uses the unitarity constraint as shown by the yellow, which roughly just means that the identity has to go to the identity as the transition amplitude. But we will skip this second idea and dive into the first idea. Okay. So how does non-uniformity of Pauli paths work? Well, to understand the Pauli paths, basically it follows from several steps. The first step is that we need to switch from the vector basis, as in the standard Feynman path integral, to the operator basis, meaning that we will no longer think about a quantum circuit as applying matrices to vectors. Instead, we will think of a quantum circuit as applying unitary channels to density matrices. And then we can think about the density matrix at each layer as a linear combination of Pauli operators, because the Pauli operators is a complete basis for operators. And then we can just think about evolving the Pauli operators. So by analogy, in the standard Feynman path integral, the transition amplitude from computational basis I to J is given by Ketbra JUI. And in the Pauli basis, we have a very similar transition amplitude from Pauli matrix SI to SJ. And the transition amplitude is given by trace of SJ times USI U dagger. And then we can simply write down the Pauli path integral as a similar sum of product of these transition amplitudes. Moreover, the Pauli matrices have a very interesting property that when we apply the noise, it simply keeps the identity basis unchanged, and XYZ, we will have a decay factor of one minus gamma, where gamma is the noise for each qubit at each time step. And therefore, we can write down the Pauli path integral of a noisy quantum circuit, which is simply given by this reweighted sum of the Pauli paths, where the contribution decays exponentially with the Hamming weight. And therefore, now the algorithm is very simple. We simply compute all the Pauli paths with at most L Hamming weights. And we can choose L to be O of log 1 of epsilon in order to achieve epsilon total variation distance. And moreover, this sum can be computed efficiently in polynomial time. So the final step is to show why is this actually a good approximation. Because this error bound is non-trivial, since the contribution of each Pauli path can be both positive and negative. But in fact, this argument is more or less identical to the previous argument showing the noise sensitivity of Boolean functions. We just use essentially the same argument with Cauchy-Schwarz orthogonality and anti-concentration. Although this property becomes a little bit different, since the key difference here is that we need this averaging over random circuits. So in particular, the proof that we just shown just uses two properties of random circuits. The first one is orthogonality, which says that if we take the product of two Pauli paths, and in expectation, by averaging over a random circuit, this product will become zero whenever the two Pauli paths are different. And second property is anti-concentration, which says that on average over a random circuit, the second moment of the output distribution is small. And then essentially the same argument for Boolean functions applies here. Okay, so that actually concludes the proof sketch. And we will have some discussion here. So overall, we know that random circuit sampling is a quite exciting experiment with multiple aspects. It is a very nice way to benchmark quantum devices, as the linear cross entropy roughly tells us how difficult it is to simulate the underlying quantum device. And furthermore, the current back and forth between quantum experiments and classical spoofing algorithms also inspires the continued improvement of quantum devices. On the other hand, there are also some issues with scaling up the RCS experiments. Theoretically, here we give strong negative evidence for random circuit sampling as a scalable experimental violation of the extended Church-Turing thesis. And practically, we also know that it is harder to perform verification of random circuit sampling as the system gets bigger. So overall, it is a very exciting time to start developing new proposals for near-term quantum computational advantage with a better complexity foundation. So the goal here is to have a task that both enables NISQ implementation and still have scalable hardness. And of course, eventually, the dream is to have an additional property of efficient verification by a classical algorithm. So finally, we will also discuss some future directions here. So an interesting fact about this result is that it is closely related to the noise sensitivity of Boolean functions. And it is very interesting to continue developing this connection to address some of the most interesting open questions, such as which quantum circuits are actually classically simulable under noise. So here, our algorithm works with high probability over random circuits, but the algorithm cannot decide which specific quantum circuits are simulable. And furthermore, the progress on this question will also deepen our understanding about the limitations for fault-tolerant quantum computation. And that's all. Thanks for your attention.